All right, we will get started. So hello and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here today and joining us for CAS's legal webinar on free speech in our schools. What are the rules for teachers, principals, and others? I'm Bill Silva. I'm the Associate Executive Director at the Connecticut Association of Schools. And I'm here with my behind the scenes colleagues, Karen Pachter, Deputy Director of CAS-CIAC, and Rosie O'Brien-Wojtek, Assistant Executive Director at CAS. And of course, our two presenters, attorneys Tom Mooney and Natalia Sierra Milan from the law firm of Shipman and Goodwin. Before I introduce Tom and Natalia, I want to thank our corporate partners, the Connecticut Army National Guard, Liberty Bank, Horace Mann, and Jostens, for their ongoing support of CAS's high-quality professional development for school leaders and educators in Connecticut. We also want to go over how we will proceed today. During the presentation, you in the audience are muted, but you may share any questions you have using the Q&A feature, and our presenters will try to answer as many of these questions as they can during the hour and a half that we have here today. We are also recording the webinar, and we will make that recording available to you in the next few days. And so now let me introduce our two presenters. Attorney Natalia Sierra Milan is an associate at Shipman and Goodwin and a member of the firm's School Law Practice Group. A graduate of Boston University and the Quinnipiac University School of Law, Natalia was the Assistant Agency Legal Director with the Connecticut Department of Children and Families and a Connecticut State Superior Court law clerk prior to joining Shipman and Goodwin. Natalia teaches school law courses at the University of Connecticut NEAG School of Education and at the School of Education at Quinnipiac University. Attorney Tom Mooney, a partner at Shipman and Goodwin, is the author of A Practical Guide to Connecticut School Law, now in its ninth edition. In addition to his extensive practice in all areas of school law, Tom teaches at the University of Connecticut School of Law and serves as professor in residence at the NEAG School of Education at the University of Connecticut. A graduate of Yale College and Harvard Law School, Tom has been widely recognized for his many notable contributions to education in Connecticut. Both Tom and Natalia are good friends to CAS, and we are very happy to have them both here today to provide their insights and guidance on the many challenging issues that they are addressing regarding free speech in our schools. Welcome, Tom and Natalia. Thank you for being here. And I now turn the presentation over to you.
Great. Well, thank you. And good afternoon, everybody. I appreciate that you're coming here and watching this. Maybe you're already home and have avoided the snow, but we have a couple more hours, I think, before it hits. So I think we're all safe and we'll get you home safe if you're not there already. What we're going to do is present 10 questions that will cover the waterfront in terms of free speech rights under the First Amendment for public employees. The questions will, Natalia and I will then answer the questions to the best of our ability. But then after the presentation, there'll be a comprehensive handout, if you will, that will be posted on the CAS website, so that you can actually do further reading and look at more specific information about these legal principles related to free speech in the school. So with that, we'll go to the first question. And you see here that one of the teachers in my building posted a criticism of her colleagues on social media, complaining that they don't give help to students after school hours. Her colleagues are incensed and want me to do something about her post. Can I do anything? Should I? And so the first question, can you, relates to whether this is speech protected by the First Amendment. And whenever I talk about the First Amendment, I think about how things used to be. And I won't say they were the good old days. I'll just say they were the way things used to be. But until 1968, the prevailing rule was that public employees had no free speech rights, that when you accepted public employment, you gave up your free speech rights because of your public responsibilities. And my favorite quote in that regard was from Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes. Some of you may have heard of. He was a famous member of the United States Supreme Court. But before that, he was on the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court. And back in 1892, he announced the rule that persisted until 1968. And he said, the petitioner may have a constitutional right to talk politics, but he has no constitutional right to be a policeman. There are few employments for hire in which the servant does not agree to suspend his constitutional right of free speech, as well as of idleness, by the implied terms of his contract. So that was the deal until 1968. And in 1968, a Mr. Pickering, who lived out in Illinois, got his complaint heard by the United States Supreme Court. He had written a letter to the editor about the superintendent's budget. And in fact, he had gotten some of the facts wrong in describing that. And so the Board of Education fired him, and he appealed all the way up to the Illinois Supreme Court, and all the courts confirmed the fact that he, without any free speech rights, had no protection and should be fired. The United States Supreme Court changed that in a case called Pickering versus Board of Education. And in that case, the court announced for the first time that public employees do have free speech rights, but they added an important limitation at the time. They said that the free speech rights of public employees relate to comment on matters of public concern. And that limitation persists, and that's the rule today. But going back to 1968, the question was Mr. Pickering talking about a matter of public concern? And he was talking about the school budget. And was the fact that he had gotten some of the facts wrong sufficient cause to terminate his employment anyway? And the court said no, that the details on which he was wrong were not reckless or malicious, and therefore he retained his protection under the First Amendment. The court then had opportunity to revisit this question in 1983 in a case called Connick versus Myers. And Harry Connick, you may know his son, the jazz musician, but Harry Connick Sr. was the prosecutor in New Orleans, and the district attorney, and one of his assistants was concerned about how she was being treated and circulated a petition with 14 questions. And the court looked at that and asked itself, was she commenting on matters of public concern? And on 13 of the 14 questions, the answer was no. But on one of the questions, which was, do you feel pressure to work on political campaigns? The court said, yeah, that's a matter of public concern. So should her speech be protected? And the Connick versus Myers decision provides now the analytical framework that we use even today. And as we go through the other questions, we're going to come back repeatedly to Connick versus Myers. And we always ask two questions. We ask, is the comment on a matter of public concern? Because if it's a matter of personal grievance, it's not protected by the First Amendment. And if it is protected by the First Amendment, we then engage in a balancing test. So the second question is, does the importance of the speech outweigh any disruptive impact of the speech? Now, going back to the first question, is this a comment on a matter of public concern? As you might imagine, that's not always clear, and it can be difficult. One of my favorite cases on this is Rankin versus McPherson, where this was, some of us remember when President Reagan was shot. And so when he was shot and it came over the news, this clerk in a police department was talking to her friend, heard it on the radio, and said, the next time they go after him, I hope they get him. And the chief of police was walking by and fired her for suggesting that it's appropriate to shoot the president of the United States. But the difficulty in defining is that a matter of public concern or not is illustrated by the court's analysis, because the court said at the time, well, she's really talking in hyperbolic terms about the president's welfare policies. And therefore, she was commenting on a matter of public concern, and she got her job back. But interestingly, and again, underscoring the importance of who sits on the United States Supreme Court, on a 5-4 vote, they ruled that that was a matter of public concern, so her speech was protected. So we have always to ask that question. And just, I'm so glad you're here to talk about these issues, because I did want to remind everyone why it's important to be respectful of the legal rights under the First Amendment. When people feel that their free speech rights have been violated, they can sue and they can bring a complaint to federal district court. And when I talk about decisions 5-4 by the Supreme Court, shows how close these questions can be. Well, if a person brings a complaint in federal court that his or her free speech rights were violated, and they were, then they not only get whatever relief they were seeking, but they also get their attorney's fees. And federal court litigation is very expensive. So we always want to be very careful in assessing whether someone has or does not have free speech rights. In the subsequent case law following Connick versus Myers, so we have first, is it a matter of public concern? And then, does the importance of the speech outweigh the disruptive aspect of the speech? The courts have helped elaborate on what is or is not disruption. And the courts have identified the following considerations. Does the speech cause conflict in the workplace? Does the speech interfere with close working relationships? For example, somebody on a blog talking about his principal is different from someone on a blog talking about the superintendent. And the former may be viewed as disruptive if the principal and the teacher have to work directly together, and teachers and superintendents don't. So we always have to look at the facts. But we look at the impact on close working relationships, the time, manner, and place of the speech, and the degree of public interest in the speech. And we're going to get into that with some of our other questions. Not everything people say is equally important. So finally, after giving you this framework, I wanted to answer the second question. We've talked about, can I do anything? And in this case, the answer would be probably not, unless that criticism was so disruptive of close working relationships that we would pick the fight and say that's unprotected speech. But in this case, it's probably not. People having their nose bent out of shape a little bit doesn't necessarily equate to disruption. But the further question is, should I? And in our law classes, Natalia and I have presented this hypothetical. And quite often we get back, well, okay, it's protected speech, but I tell the person, you should be careful, you're upsetting your colleagues. And the problem with that is that you're now putting that on the radar. And if that person gets transferred or disciplined, that person is going to point to that conversation and say, I exercised my right of free speech. They didn't like it. They told me about it. And now I'm on bus duty, or whatever the consequence is. So when you think that speech is protected, and if you don't like it, engage in your own speech for sure, but don't talk about how you don't like the speech that the public employee has made, because that's just giving that person a potential claim down the road. So that's the overview. I told Natalia I'd do that in 10 minutes, and I didn't, was a little longer, but we'll move on to question two.
Okay.
Natalia.
Terrific. Question two. I received an anonymous tip to tell me that a custodian in my school has a vlog, which is the video blog on YouTube, that I should check out. I found the vlog and I was disgusted to see him and a friend purporting to give graphic advice about sexual matters. Would I violate his free speech rights if I tell him to knock it off? So this is the part in the presentation where Tom and I would typically ask one of you to tell us what you think, just because I'm intrigued to find out what everybody thinks about this question, because it is sort of a challenging question. But in this situation, typically we ask the question of whether the conduct can affect, has the potential of affecting the employee's ability to do his job. And so the answer to that is more than likely it depends. Creating a vlog outside of work doesn't necessarily affect the custodian's job, but if the vlog is highly vulgar and the custodians interact with children, and if it becomes known to a parent in the community, then it can create that disruption that Tom was talking about. And so that would not be protected under the Connick versus Myers balancing test that Tom just went over. So the threshold question is whether or not the vlog even meets the first condition of the protection under the First Amendment, right? Does the speech relate to a matter of public concern? So even if we presume that the speech relates in some way to a matter of public concern, it's clear that the speech is not protected if we proceed to the second part of the Connick versus Myers test, which is the balancing test. Because vulgarity expressed in the grossest of terms by two adults in a public forum that is accessible to children has no importance, and it brings discredit to the speakers. So the impact of this vlog could actually be significant and disruptive. Imagine, for an instance, that either a colleague or a parent comes across the vlog and questions whether or not this individual should be employed by the district any longer. So it is possible that as a result of posting something so vulgar, the person's job might be at stake, because it will create such a disruption that it will be impossible to sort of bottle up again. So as Tom mentioned earlier today, you're gonna get a sort of a supplemental question and answers document. And in that you'll have a bunch of cases that illustrate that very point. And one of the cases that Tom and I frequently mention in our law school class is the Metzer versus Board of Education of the City of New York. And it is kind of a gross case, but not really. And I say gross, but not really, because in that instance, the New York City Board of Education fired a teacher because he was the editor of a newsletter for an organization that advocated sexual relationships between men and boys. And so even though there wasn't any evidence of actual misconduct, the Second Circuit in that case in 2003 rejected that teacher's claim that his free speech rights were violated. And so the termination actually stood. And the court in that case actually held that his speech, even though it was made outside of the school, was likely to impair the teacher's effectiveness and to cause disruption for the same reasons that we just went over. If a colleague were to come across it or happen to know, or if a parent were to come across it, which in that case they did, and call into question that person's fitness as a teacher. So with that, I think I made up the time that you stole, Tom.
Great. So we move on to question three. But as we do that, I just wanted to remind everyone that this is free legal advice. We do welcome your questions. And Bill and mentioned that we will have some time at the end of the presentation to answer your questions. But we do have this Q&A feature. And as we're going along, if you have questions about something we've said or wish us to clarify a point, please feel free. We both teach at a law school and we're used to being interrupted and questioned. So we would welcome your questions. On the other hand, if we've been perfectly clear, we understand that you don't have questions. So just feel free though to ask questions as we're going along. So question three is probably the question I've answered the most in the last year. And it goes as follows. One of the maintenance workers in my school is active on Instagram, and he has posted a number of terrible memes making fun of immigrants, Blacks, women, and people with disabilities. I wrote him up and threatened that he will be fired if he keeps it up. However, in response, he filed a grievance claiming that he has a First Amendment right to express himself on his Instagram account. Does he? And the first question is, what's an Instagram account? But I understand that it's a social media where you take pictures of your lunch or dinner or whatever, but you can also post pictures and memes. And so many misguided public employees post things that are upsetting and disrespectful. And the question is the First Amendment protection applicable to such posts? And by way of introducing the topic, I will point out a general premise in First Amendment law, and that is that we don't need the First Amendment to protect people in saying things people want to hear. The First Amendment exists to protect people's right to say things that people don't want to hear. And so that's the framework here. And now the question is, well, what about these things that people read and get upset about? Are these protected by the First Amendment? And Natalia gave you the answer to all of these questions, which is it depends. In this case, it's going to depend upon the Connick versus Myers balancing test. And we'll just presume, I don't think I'd want to fight about whether immigration is a matter of public concern or how we accommodate people with disabilities. But when we get to the balancing test, this maintenance worker has a serious problem. And that is that how important is his speech? Because we're balancing again in Connick versus Myers, the importance of the speech versus the disruptive impact of the speech. So how important is it that this this maintenance person post hateful memes? And the answer is not very. So what is the disruptive aspect of the speech? And I've seen circumstances where parents bring these posts to the attention of the administration. And it's really very moving how they feel that, you know, their child comes to school and here's a person in the school district that is being disrespectful, hateful toward his or her child and his or her child's racial identity or ethnic background. We look at these situations and we would typically say that you can't do that and that you are in fact disrupting education when you make people feel unwelcome in the schools. So that's how we would typically handle these lame attempts at humor. It's much more complicated though, when it's not a terrible meme, but rather it's a statement that goes contrary to the general view. And it's a statement to which some people take umbrage. That's when we have to be very careful in balancing the importance of the speech and unfettered debate on issues like immigration. We have to be careful about that. On the other hand, just like with Mr. Meltzer, if people say things that will cause them, that will interfere with their ability to do their public employment, then they forfeit their right to make those statements or forfeit their job. I noticed that there's a question in the chat.
Yes, someone asked specifically about hate speech, which may kind of take this question to the next dimension, because I know in some places there are specific laws regulating speech defined as hate speech.
Yeah, well, that's a very challenging area of constitutional law. And that is that there are certain words that are certain statements that are not protected. Fighting words, for example. There are different codes where we talk about hate speech and where the speech falls within the definition, then that would be unprotected speech if the definition is appropriately written. And sometimes the litigation over these definitions will focus on whether the prohibition is overly broad or if it is an adequate protection of a legitimate concern. And I see the next question here is, would it be different if a teacher, as opposed to the maintenance worker, were posting the meme? And I would say that it's a materially different situation. It may be that even a maintenance worker could be subject to discipline for these hateful memes, but a teacher who is directly engaged with students and families has a special responsibility. So I think argument in favor of regulation, in favor of the district not permitting that speech, would be significantly stronger if it's a teacher, or God forbid, an administrator who's posting these things. Again, this is perfect. I so appreciate the questions as we're going along, and I'll turn it back over to Natalia for question four.
Thank you. Question four. We recently had an open house, remote, of course, and a parent just informed me that her son's math teacher candidly told her during open house that the new curriculum is no good and that he's glad his children do not attend this school. I confronted the teacher, but he told me that he has the right to express his opinion on matters of public concern. Really? So the answer to this question, I'm glad to say, is no, not really, he doesn't. Speech expressed as part of one's duties is not protected by the First Amendment, even if it relates to matters of public concern. And so the rule is actually set out in a 2006 US Supreme Court called Garcetti versus Sabalos. And in Garcetti, an assistant district attorney there claimed that his free speech rights were violated when he suffered an adverse employment action after an earlier draft of a report he wrote was used to advantage a criminal defendant. And in that case, as Tom mentioned, just to illustrate how close some of these decisions are, in a 5-4 vote, the US Supreme Court held that the speech had no protection under the First Amendment. And in that packet that you'll be receiving, there's some quotes that we put in there for you. But the concept of that speech pursuant to duty is not protected has been broadly construed. And just earlier this month, our Second Circuit dismissed a First Amendment claim by a teacher employed by the New York City Board of Education, where the teacher filed a number of grievances under the collective bargaining agreement, claiming that the Board of Education retaliated against him for exercising his free speech rights in doing so. But the court there affirmed a previous ruling on the subject and actually ruled that the teacher's grievances under the collective bargaining agreement were not protected speech because they didn't relate to a matter of public concern. Interestingly, though, Connecticut does have a statute conferring First Amendment protections on employees in the private sector. And the Connecticut court initially adopted the Garcetti versus Sabalos rule in interpreting that statute in a case involving a school principal claiming free speech rights in the school setting. But at that time, the court did leave open the question of whether the free speech protections of the Connecticut Constitution actually confer any greater protection than those of the United States Supreme Court's under that Garcetti standard. But finally, in 2015, the Connecticut Supreme Court answered that question for us and held that the Connecticut Constitution does indeed confer state free speech protections on public employees. So in that case, the Connecticut Supreme Court declined to follow the Garcetti rule and interpreted the statute. The head of a company in that case concluded, the head of the company's valuation unit concluded the real estate valuations were too high and recommended that investors be informed. The company disagreed with him, and ultimately the employee was fired. Then he sued in federal court, and the court certified a question to the Connecticut Supreme Court, namely whether the Connecticut court should follow that Garcetti rule. And the court there said no. The court declined to actually follow that rule and held that they should follow the balancing test of the Connick versus Myers test that we've been talking about. So speech that is related to job responsibilities is protected by the Connecticut Constitution and that statute, which is 31-51Q, but only if it relates to official dishonesty or other serious wrongdoings or threats to health and safety. Otherwise, the employee's right to maintain order in the workplace is always going to prevail. So with that, Tom, I don't see any questions in the chat. I think you have question five.
Very good. Question five. Our school resource officer recently started wearing a cap with the thin blue line insignia to show support for the police. However, two students have claimed that the cap makes them feel unsafe, and they're insisting that the school resource officer not wear the cap. However, he has claimed that a directive not to wear the cap would violate his First Amendment rights. So we have that tension. This is, as you can see, we're not terribly creative in making up these questions. This is a very, in fact, a case that, a situation where we were asked for our advice. And so if we were in person, I would ask you to raise your hand if you think the students feeling unsafe should prevail, or whether the First Amendment rights of the school resource officer to support the police by wearing that cap should prevail. So I'll just pause there. We can't vote, but I want to feel the tension between those two principles, both of which are legitimate, and who prevails. In the first instance, I have to ask the question, can he wear that cap? I thought he has a uniform, and shouldn't his uniform be what he wears? And I'm sure the thin blue line insignia is not the issue, standard issue hat for a school resource officer. So, we repeatedly ask this question. Has the public employer created a forum for expressing speech? Is this an opportunity for this police officer to speak, or is this not? Is this the opportunity for the police officer to wear his uniform? So before we even get into the First Amendment analysis, I would ask the question, can he really do that? But let's just say somehow, because he was doing it, that it was not a problem with the uniform. So now the question is, how do we apply the learning here? First, is it a matter of public concern, support for the police? Absolutely. So now we get into the balancing test. And that is, actually, let me just back up to the uniform piece. So if we could enforce the uniform, then Garcetti would apply. It wouldn't be a First Amendment issue because he's just doing his job, wearing the hat. But as soon as we open the door to individual expression through dress, then it is potentially a First Amendment issue. And under Connick versus Myers, we have to balance the interests. On the one hand, these kids say they feel unsafe. Is that disruptive? And I'll candidly admit that I find that question very challenging, because I don't want to empower students or anyone else to weaponize their emotions to prohibit speech that they don't like. So in fact, there's no case on this, so we're not going to end up telling you, well, and the answer is, all we can do is give you the analytical framework. But so we have this students feeling unsafe, but if those students are sincerely expressing their view and somehow this speech is making them feel unwelcome in the school setting, and if that's affecting the educational process, then that's a disruption that we have to take into account. And against that disruption, we balance the importance of the speech. And as we said before, one of the factors of balance, how do we assess disruption? How do we assess importance? Time, manner, and place of speech is a factor we consider. And although speaking in favor of the police is a very important public policy statement, it may not be important to do it when you're doing your job and causing people to be uncomfortable. So we don't have an answer. I think the situation was finessed, but it's a very interesting circumstance because it really underscores the tension that we feel between the importance of speech on the one hand and having the school environment be welcoming to all students on the other. So Bill, are there some questions?
Yes, so one is kind of a simple follow-up. What if the thin blue line insignia had been an actual part of the uniform, so not an add-on? Would that change?
Yes.
Determination.
At that point, we now have the imprimatur of the government. That's the uniform. In fact, that's a very good question because someone could say, I feel unsafe to have a uniformed police officer in the building. So that is a legitimate question. And I would say that if this cap or any other accoutrement of their uniform was the subject of the discomfort, it's a different case and the balance would be struck. It's important to have people comply with the uniform requirements. And I'm still not predicting with certainty how it comes out, but making it part of the uniform removes this free speech piece of it. And it really is more a matter of, do students have the right to tell the school district how the police uniforms should be provided? Are there...
Yeah, so the other is maybe too large of a question. It asks, what rights do students have in the case that most often they're minors, and does that impact the rights that they have and that they can claim? So again, that may be too broad for this presentation, but
well,
I wanted to raise it anyway.
Well, it's a very good question. And in this particular case, the students, absent some special education claim that, you know, they were not providing a free appropriate public education, simply having a discomfort is a condition, is a fact that we need to take into account. But we're weighing that fact against a potential constitutional right by the police officer. I don't think students have a right. They have a right to their own self-expression, but they don't have a constitutional right to tell other people how they should express themselves. So I don't think it's a question of student rights here. I think it's a question of our concern over their discomfort. And sometimes that concern is amplified by the parents themselves. These issues often come forward with the students unsafe, and now we have the parent with the student saying, this is unacceptable and this is why. So I hope that's a helpful clarification in terms of rights, because I see the other question is, it becomes whose right is more important. And in this particular case, it's who is our judgment over whether the free speech rights of the employee outweigh our concerns, as opposed to the rights of other people, other than in a I'm now being a lawyer. I'm sorry for that. Because when we talk about rights, we typically are saying, and section such and such of the statutes give us this right, or the Constitution gives us this right. In this case, we talk more casually, but importantly about the right of students to attend school in a feeling safe. But that's, there's not a statute that says that. That's just good education.
Great. So someone raised a question in the chat in terms of how board policy about some things like dress code and free speech would be part of this discussion, I guess, and free speech discussion generally.
There are two points to that. First, the quite often boards have policies about student dress, but that would be a separate issue. The relative to the free speech rights of employees, school districts often adopt social media policies, and they say what employees can do. 3:42 p.m. Oh, okay. In this case, we have to be careful that school boards don't overstep. In other words, you can adopt a policy, but if it's unconstitutional, it's not going to be enforceable. And many social media policies are viewed as overly broad and unenforceable. So let me move on to Natalia in question 6.
Perfect. Thank you, Karen. So this is perhaps, I know Tom has answered the other question, question number 3 probably the most, but this is probably the one question I've gotten over the last year, more so than other questions. So some teachers have been displaying Black Lives Matter in their classrooms. A parent observed such a sign during a classroom visit, and he angrily claims the teachers are violating the board policy prohibiting school employees from engaging in political activity while at work. Should I tell the teachers to stop displaying their Black Lives Matter signs? So this question is a gnarly question to answer because it raises two separate issues. The first issue is that teachers who display Black Lives Matter signs or insignia, are they engaged in partisan policy activity or political activity? And the second issue that it raises is, what is the legal impact of permitting teachers to display the signs in their classroom? So the first question we typically ask ourselves is whether the superintendent and the Board of Education should interpret board policy in defining what activity is and is not partisan political activity that would violate the policy. So in determining whether displaying Black Lives Matter signs is a political activity, we have in the past couple of months resorted to actually a memo that was issued by the United States Office of Special Counsel, in which it determined that the Black Lives Matter movement is a social movement, not a political activity. And so federal employees are free to display Black Lives Matter signs and insignia, so long as they don't combine those actions with any political activity, of course. So I think it's reasonable to determine that displaying Black Lives Matter signs in classrooms is not a political activity. But that being said, we still have the second portion of our inquiry, which is permitting the display of those signs, does it have any sort of legal significance, and what is the implication? So whenever, as Tom mentioned in one of the questions we just answered, when a public entity creates a forum for speech, you can't engage in viewpoint discrimination. What that means is that if you permit one type of speech, you can't restrict another. So classrooms generally are not considered forums for employee free speech. So when personnel expression is permitted, like in this instance, if we allow the display of Black Lives Matter signs, then we create a forum. And then teachers with opposing views, for example, have to also be permitted the same opportunity to express themselves. So there is a significant exception to the rule though here. And so as some boards across the state have asked us this question, we have often said in the first instance, if you want to permit this expression, you can. Just know that you can't discriminate based on point of view. But ultimately, using the Connick versus Myers balancing test that we keep talking about, whatever expression that might be, if we have an opposing expression that's perhaps disruptive and impacts our ability to effectively run a district, then the speech can actually be, we can actually restrict that speech. So it's important to know that if we generally classrooms are not considered a public forum, if we do make it a public forum, then we have to permit opposing views or any differing views, but we always have the ability to restrict it if and when it becomes disruptive. I think we have some questions.
Yes, sorry, we have several follow-ups to that. So one is distinguishing between Black Lives Matter as an organization versus Black Lives Matter as a slogan, and how that fits in. Someone asked about a different slogan, the Don't Tread on Me slogan and flag. And then someone asked the broader question about how you define political speech versus social. I think that was one of the distinctions that you made in your response. So those are three questions, and they're still coming in.
Yeah, I can see. I was starting to see them trickling in, and I thought to myself, oh, yikes, what did I get myself into by answering this question? So let me just answer first the question of whether or not the Don't Tread on Me is a political symbol. I don't know the answer to that, which is why I'm happy to answer that first. I don't know whether Tom happens to know that. I don't know. I don't believe that it is a political symbol. Typically, when we think about political speech, we think about partisan speech. Go ahead, Tom.
I'm just gonna agree with you, Natalia. At one point, Don't Tread on Me was partisan political activity. I think it was about 200 years ago. At this point, there are no political parties, and that's their slogan. And in the analysis that Natalia mentioned from the Office of the Special Counsel, the focus is partisan political speech, that we don't want our public, federal employees. This is the Hatch Act. Some of you may have heard of it. The Hatch Act prohibits partisan political activity by federal employees. And board policies talking about political activity are typically focused on partisan political activity. So that would be more of a historical reference, or perhaps calling on the history to make a point currently, but it wouldn't relate to a political party and elections, which is the major concern. So back to you, Natalia.
Right, and then let me just look at the other questions, Bill, really quickly.
So one asked about distinguishing Black Lives Matter as an organization versus as a slogan. And then actually, I think Tom just addressed the meaning of political in this context, right, in terms of partisan political party affiliated activity, so.
Right, so I don't see a difference in terms of our analysis between Black Lives Matter as a social movement and Black Lives Matter as a slogan. I mean, to me, they're one and the same. I think that when boards of education are making a decision of whether or not to permit teachers or any other board employee to display signs or wear some insignia or wear a t-shirt that says Black Lives Matter, I think they just have to ask the first question of, are we ready to create a public forum where we otherwise are not required to have one? And so that is sort of the first threshold question that one should ask. And then always balance with that, the fact that once you do, you have to recognize that there's gonna be people that feel differently than those that support Black Lives Matter. And what are you gonna do when that happens? But obviously you cross that bridge when you get to it.
Thank you.
Yeah, just to elaborate on that a little more, when we deal with this, we're dealing with the slogan because all we see is the slogan in the in the classroom. We recognize that the organization and its political agenda, et cetera, is far more complicated than that simple sign that you might see in a classroom. So we focus in on what is essentially the superficial appearance, what is being posted in the classroom, and the larger issues involving the Black Lives Matter organization is essentially a different question, but we do recognize that those are two separate questions. So with that, I think we're caught up, and I'll move on to question 7. One of the teachers in my school has a blog, and almost every day she posts her account from the trenches as a classroom teacher. Last week, she referred in her blog to one of her students who has an anxiety disorder as a snowflake who would benefit from joining the Army. The parent is demanding that we fire this teacher. Does the teacher have a free speech right to post to her blog? Again, this is where you raise your hand one way or the other. We go back to Connick versus Myers and first ask, is this a matter of public concern? Probably not. So the analysis could just end there. And this wouldn't be protected speech, and how we deal with it would depend on many factors, past history, the scope of the disruption. Is there any way to remediate the situation through further conversation and apology? This may well simply be an employment issue, not a First Amendment issue. But as we indicated before, it's not always possible reliably to say this is or is not a matter of public concern. So we typically move to the balancing test. And you just wonder what people are thinking sometimes when they put out statements on social media and why they think we want to hear what they have to say. And what they have to say can so often create problems for them. And there are any number of teacher blog cases where the teachers have been fired as a result. Because when you balance what's the importance of her condescending view about this child with an anxiety disorder? What is the impact on that student and on the school community for a teacher to be so unsupportive of a child with a disability? So when we get to the balancing test, we would see this as a real problem for this teacher. And we wouldn't see that she would have the right under the First Amendment to say these things which are so concerning to parents. And in the materials that we keep talking about, we're going to give you just a sampling of 3 different cases where teachers have lost their claims under the First Amendment. The first is a case from the Ninth Circuit where a teacher was on her blog saying nasty things about her coworkers, about the union, about her employer more generally. And she was transferred and brought a First Amendment claim saying her transfer was retaliatory. And the court made short work of her claim and said, and we go back to what factors do we balance? How do we measure disruption? Did it disrupt coworker relations? Did it affect close working relationships? Did it impact the performance of her duties? And the court answered all of those questions, yes, that this was a problem. If a teacher is being nasty online, other teachers aren't going to want to work with her. They're not going to feel safe because they're going to engage professionally with that teacher and find themselves potentially humiliated through some sort of blog post. it's a perfect illustration of the concern that we have about disrupting close working relationships. But there are other cases involving students. One teacher was on her blog making demeaning comments about children with disabilities, about parental protection of their children in a sarcastic way. And she was terminated, and she brought a claim under the First Amendment. And the court said that her speech was unprotected because it affected her effectiveness as a teacher. Parents wouldn't feel comfortable working with her if they know that she's fundamentally disrespecting them and their children. And in another case, the teacher posted on social media that in her class, composed largely of minority students, she referred to her position as being that of a warden for future criminals. And she was fired, and she claimed that that was an exercise of free speech, and she lost. And just this year, in fact, just last month, a teacher's termination was affirmed by a California court, where she was on social media making snotty comments about students who were protesting discrimination on the basis of national origin and immigration status. In part, she just liked some comment about how school ran better that day. And in another, she engaged in some students telling them they should get over themselves, that she had the right to say what she said. And as she found out later, she didn't. And she was terminated from her employment. Self-inflicted wound. She's on social media saying things that undermined her effectiveness as a teacher. And so that we're almost to question 8, but I see something in the chat.
Yes, Tom. Someone asked in this example where the teacher is posting or making a comment about a student, would FERPA be relevant to this response?
Absolutely. Now, FERPA, if anyone made the mistake of referring to a student by name, that would be personally identifiable student information and FERPA violation and a separate concern that could lead to discipline up to including termination. But FERPA talks about personally identifiable information, which is quite often information that doesn't include the name, but nonetheless, people know who you're talking about. And I appreciate the question. FERPA is a significant concern, and teachers can't take comfort in thinking, well, gee, if I don't mention the kid's name, everything's fine, because often it isn't, because people know who the teacher is talking about. And the teacher is not only antagonizing parents and students, but is violating federal law.
Thank you.
So we'll move on, Natalia, to question 8.
Am I muted?
Not now.
Okay. I lost the screen, so I can't see it.
Do you want me to read the question? Did you lost the screen?
I did. I lost the screen. Would you mind reading the question?
Not at all.
Thank you.
One of the teachers in my school is constantly in my office complaining that I'm not doing enough to promote social justice in my school. Finally, I had enough and told the teacher to knock it off. 2 weeks later, I assigned her to outdoor bus duty, and she is threatening to sue me for violating her free speech rights. But we only talked privately. What free speech rights could she be talking about? Back to you.
Thank you, Tom. So this question just highlights how much we often think about the exercise of free speech as sort of this big public event. But the protections of the First Amendment do apply whether you're speaking in public or whether you're speaking privately about certain things. So the teacher still has a burden of proof in proving her claim that we sort of assigned her to outdoor bus duty as a retaliatory measure, but it is a claim that she can make. So in 1979, the US Supreme Court addressed the issue directly in one of the cases that you'll see in your materials. And in that particular case, an English teacher repeatedly expressed concern to her principal that the district was making inadequate efforts to address racial inequities. And so at the end of that year, her contract wasn't renewed. And so she claimed the retaliation for her previous speech. And the district defended on the basis that the teacher's speech was not private in nature, but the court unanimously ruled that the First Amendment protections apply even to private speech. So the decision to defend on that basis is a curious one, because a favorable ruling would have impelled teachers and others with concerns to raise those concerns publicly in the first instance in order to enjoy the protections of the First Amendment. But it's very clear that speech doesn't lose its protection, even though you're talking behind closed doors. And so even though it's challenging to distinguish between private speech on a matter of public concern, it is in fact protected. But private speech pursuant to duty, as we talked a little while ago, is not, according to Garcetti versus Zavallos. So the distinction might be whether the speech relates to somebody's job duties, which would be considered unprotected speech pursuant to duty, and speech that does not pertain to somebody's job duties. So finally, the one thought that we wanted to leave you with is that we have to remember that speech can be protected in ways other than the First Amendment. As you all know, people can file grievances, for example, right? And so grievances are protected because they're concerted activity under the applicable collective bargaining law. And also advocating for greater gender equity is speech protected under Title IX. So with that, I leave Tom for question 9, and I'll figure out my screen.
Okay, well, good luck. Just to punctuate what Natalia just said, it was really an interesting case where a male basketball coach was complaining about how female athletes were treated, and the school district defended on the fact that he was not the victim of discrimination. He's a male, and there was no claim that he was suffering on the basis of gender. And the United States Supreme Court rejected that argument and said that when people suffer negative consequences for advocating under Title IX, that's a Title IX violation itself, even though the speaker is not the protected group under Title IX. How are you doing with that screen, Natalia? Did you figure it out?
Yep, I found it.
Good. Okay, question 9. I've read enough about employee free speech rights to know that the First Amendment does not protect employee whining. However, when I chastise an employee for complaining about me on social media, the union claimed that I had committed an unfair labor practice. What could the union be talking about? And this is an important point within the whole free speech category. We just talked about the Jackson versus Birmingham case where the coach advocated under Title IX, and that was protected speech. Well, people also have the right to protected speech in the union context. And the question here is, was this just a matter of personal concern, or was that employee seeking support or information from others and therefore or thereby engaging in protected concerted activity? So when people are online talking about their working conditions, we might see that as, oh, they're just whiners and complaining about their working conditions, but those complaints, if they relate to working conditions, may well be protected speech under the labor laws. We have in Connecticut 3 different labor laws protecting public employees. We have the Teacher Negotiation Act protecting teachers and administrators. We have the Municipal Employees Relations Act protecting municipal employees and the non-certified employees of boards of education. And we have the State Employee Relations Act which protects state employees in their union activities. So when this post is in social media and relating to working conditions, we have to assess whether this is simply grousing about a matter of private concern or whether that employee is engaging in protected concerted activity. We do not have a case in the public sector on this in Connecticut, but we do have a case in the private sector in Connecticut where some employees of the Triple Play Sports Bar and Grill were on media, social media, complaining about their employer. And the employer said they violated the social media policy and they were disciplined. And they filed an unfair labor practice charge with the NLRB. And the NLRB found in their favor, saying that these statements on social media, which in one case involved liking a post made by someone else, were protected activity because they related to their working conditions. So with that, I'll turn back to Natalia and we'll talk about question 10.
Okay, and I'll try to be quick to give people an opportunity to ask questions. So one of my teachers has touched many a sore nerve in his regular rants on Facebook about the Board of Education and the superintendent. My problem is that he's also a poor teacher. I should put him on a plan, but I'm afraid that he will claim that we are retaliating against him for exercising his free speech rights. What should I do? I'm guessing that at least once in your career, you have come across this issue, and it's unfortunate. And so, as Tom would often say, you have to do what you have to do, and you have to dare to be great. So if the teacher is that outspoken, it's possible that he's going to file that claim, and there's nothing we can do about it. Right. But the U.S. Supreme Court has addressed this particular issue and has held that a teacher should not be better off for exercising free speech rights when there's an independent cause for discipline and that can be imposed. So in that particular case, the U.S. Supreme Court had to deal with the teacher that calls students SOBs, I won't say it out loud, and made an obscene gesture to girls who didn't follow his directives, and even got into an argument over serving a spaghetti in the school cafeteria. But this guy did a whole lot more than that. He also went on a radio talk show and criticized the superintendent's dress code for staff and a bunch of other things. So when his contract wasn't renewed, he claimed First Amendment protection. He claimed that his rights had been violated. So the U.S. Supreme Court in that case determined that he was full of it, right? And they held that when an employee would have been disciplined without regard to the speech, there's no First Amendment violation. And the court very clearly said that an employee shouldn't be better off as a result of a speech, of a First Amendment speech. And the employee can act whenever there's an independent reason for terminating the employer. There's also cases in Connecticut that talk about this issue, particularly about 12 years ago, a non-tenured teacher created a MySpace account and administrators heard about the account and reviewed it and ultimately concluded that the content was inappropriate and that the teacher hadn't maintained appropriate boundaries with students. So even though the teacher closed the account without telling the administrators, he went ahead and created another account under a different name, if you can believe it. And the teacher included similar information on this new account. And several of the friends on their accounts were, in fact, yet again, students. So when the school officials discovered these facts, they placed the teacher on leave and the contract wasn't renewed. And so he, of course, sued because this is America. And he alleged all sorts of constitutional violations, including a violation of his First Amendment rights. And so in that case, in the Connecticut case, the district court dismissed the claims and actually determined that there was very little on that MySpace account that related to a matter of public concern. So given these and a bunch of other cases that we have nationwide, it's pretty clear that being outspoken and controversial doesn't necessarily insulate you as a teacher or as any other public employee for that matter from any discipline that would come your way independent of your free speech. So with that, I believe we have concluded our presentation, unless there's something you want to add, Tom. I know you wanted to just wrap it up. You're muted, Tom.
Thank you. Just wanted to underscore what we say here today, which is now you've heard perhaps more than you want to hear about the Connick's versus Myers balancing test. But that is the framework in which we work, unless someone's speaking pursuant to duty, like if a teacher's in a classroom talking about the federal deficit or the war in Afghanistan, that's not protected speech because that teacher is doing his or her job. But more often than not, we're talking about social media and speech that is not directly related to someone's job, but rather their sharing of opinions that they have on matters of public concern. And so you know the framework, but the particular facts are going to be critically important. And specifically, before you pick a fight, you want to be able to point to the particular disruption that causes your concern. And if you don't have that disruption to point to, then you should probably just keep your mouth shut and move on, because picking the issue without good cause will just give that individual an opportunity to claim retaliation, even though we know that you're good people and you would never retaliate against anyone for unpopular opinions. So Bill, I don't know if there are any other questions or if you'd like to open it up to questions, but we have a couple more minutes if there are any.
Yeah, thank you, Tom and Natalia. I will ask if there's anyone in the audience with a question, if you can share it in the Q&A, and you have the opportunity to have two of school off finest advocates here to answer your questions, if anyone would like to bring something to the fore. So I will open it up. Is a teacher free to swear on social media?
Great question. Well, I think both Natalia and I will offer your perspective. And that is, sure, but it depends. In other words, we would resort to the analysis, and that is, if some teacher swears, well, related to a matter of public concern, that goddamn war in Afghanistan, for example, then we would apply the balancing test. And swearing, as so many other things, exists along a continuum. And so it's not a per se rule, but if a person is being vulgar online, as was the case with the vlog that Natalia talked about, someone's being vulgar in a way that causes serious concern about their suitability to be with children, then the balance could strike against protecting that speech. So Natalia, any other comment on that?
No, I think the only thing I would just offer, which is not different than yours, is it depends on where that swear word is in the context of a sentence. We talked about some cases in which there was a lot of swearing about students, for example. And so if it's directed at students, it is not a matter of public concern. So to your point, Tom, if it's a matter of public concern, possibly, but if the context of the sentence or in other comments around it will be part of that analysis.
There's another question asking about the instance of liking a comment on Facebook or retweeting something on Twitter. Is that speech? Or could it be could that action be construed as speech?
Yes. At the risk of being unlawyerly and answering a question in a single word, yes. And we would apply the same tests to the speech. In fact, in the AAA Grill, Bar and Grill case, one of the people just liked a comment made by someone else, and that was viewed as protected concerted activity.
Right. There's a rather long example here in the chat. We recently had a virtual board meeting where a staff member unknowingly used a vulgar homophobic labeling of a district staff member without knowing their microphone was unmuted. In speaker view, the teacher's name was displayed and building administration confirmed it did sound like the staff member in question. Beyond proving that, students were present at the meeting as we were celebrating teams and this staff member subjected them to this action. Is this protected speech if it was not directed at anyone and was not meant to be public?
I love these questions. We could go all night with this, but we won't. One vivid case I recall involving student speech where a kid wrote something to himself in a little thing, but it was hateful, it was awful. And his friend stole it and gave it to the principal and he was expelled because it was about how he was going to engage in violence against a girl. He didn't intend that be public, but he was held accountable for his speech. And I would apply the same analysis here. It's a self-inflicted wound to be sure, but this person can be held accountable. It was speech. He said something, it was heard, and now he would be held accountable.
Okay, thank you. We may have time for one more question if there's one more brave soul out there. I'll give it just a few seconds. Okay, someone popped in. Do these things change when a social media account is private?
Maybe. Just like that kid who wrote that thing, you know, that he wasn't intending anyone to read, if no one read it, then it wouldn't be a problem. But it was read and it was a problem. And similarly, there are any number of cases where people are on social media in, quote, a private setting, and someone brings that speech forward. And you're not protected from the consequences of your speech by trying to keep it private. Just like if you're in a room with three people and you say something hateful, and no one complains about it, it's not going to be an issue. Back to Connick versus Myers, we're always looking, what is the impact of the speech? And it's not that you tried to keep it private and you failed. You don't get any credit for that. You get accountability for the speech that you expressed. And so it's a factor. If people have a private setting and therefore they're problematic speech doesn't become a distraction or disruption, then good for them. But their efforts to make it private has never been a defense. Natalia, I don't know if you have anything further on that.
I was just going to share an anecdote, which was we had a situation in the district where an individual originally had a very public profile that contained inappropriate content for students, and students sort of came upon it. And the question was raised, would this have been an issue, whether I made it private or not? And I think if I can leave you with just one piece of information is that lawyers are very good detectives. And so nothing is really private, even if you set it to private. And that's just the nature of social media.
Great. Well, thank you. I'm going to preempt and just on behalf of all of our listeners, and you could tell by the number of questions and the engagement on chat how attentive everyone was and how focused they were and how informative and useful and valuable your presentation was. So Tom and Natalia, thank you so much. We always enjoy having you at CAS for our webinars, and they're always lively and informative, and we just appreciate you so much. So thank you for being here and bringing your wisdom and guidance, as always, to our listeners. I want to thank CAS's corporate partners once again, the Connecticut Army National Guard, Liberty Bank, Horace Mann and Jostens for their support of professional development for Connecticut school leaders. I want to thank everyone in the audience for attending today. We will have the recording of today's webinar available in a few days. You'll receive notification of that soon. And also the additional materials that Tom and Natalia have prepared will be available as well. We have a lot of CAS webinars coming up after the new year, so please look for our weekly news blast. In addition to reading Tom's legal mailbag, look for the announcements of upcoming webinars and events, and always on our webpage at CAS-CIAC.org, you can get details about upcoming events and activities. On behalf of CAS, I want to wish everyone a good rest of your day. Stay safe tonight and tomorrow with the snowstorm. Have a good end to the week and a joyous holiday season. Stay safe. Thank you. And goodbye, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.